All right, Crystal, what's on your radar?
Well, last week, I interviewed Jimmy Dore about his idea for progressives to withhold their vote for Pelosi as Speaker unless she allows a floor vote on Medicare for All. Take a listen.
Progressives are always told that they don't know how to use power. They don't know how to grab power. Well, they don't have power, right? But the progressives who are elected in Congress right now, I mean the real progressives, not the 100 people in the Progressive Caucus. I'm talking about the Squad, Cori Bush, Jamal Bowman, Ro Khanna, people like that, Ariana Presley, people who are actually have progressive policies. Now they have leverage. What's their leverage, Jimmy? Well, Nancy Pelosi needs their vote for Speaker, right? Because the Democrats and Nancy Pelosi performed so poorly that they lost They lost seats in the House under Donald Trump. So now the margin is really small, right? So just a handful of progressives could say, Nancy Pelosi, we're withholding our vote from you for Speaker unless you bring up Medicare for All for vote on the floor. That's our deal. Now it's up to Nancy Pelosi. Do you want to risk your speakership or do you want to make sure we have a vote on a basic human right?
Now, I can understand quite easily why corporatists would oppose this idea. Of course, they despise all progressive priorities that remotely challenge corporate power. But I was surprised to see the arguments being made against the idea from some on the left, chief among them, AOC. Now, the entry of AOC into this conversation really started with a tweet from Chargers running back and left activist Justin Jackson. He wrote, "If AOC and the Squad don't do what Jimmy Dore suggested and withhold their vote for Pelosi for speakership unless Medicare for All gets brought to the floor for a vote, they will be revealing themselves. Power concedes nothing without a demand." Pretty sound reasoning to me, but AOC did not agree. She responded, "Problem with this idea is that there isn't enough thought given to step two. The Dem votes aren't there yet, and with a razor-thin margin, the Dem knows are greater than the margin. So you issue threats, hold your vote, and lose. Then what?" She continued, "In contrast, you can use leverage to push for things that can happen and change lives, i.e. a $15 minimum wage vote in the first 100 days, doable. Elevating longtime progressive champions to important positions of leadership, also doable. That's the opportunity cost to weigh." And in addition to this exchange with Justin, AOC also responded to a Matt Stoller tweet to indicate that actually progressives are demanding things in exchange for their speaker vote. They're just doing so quietly behind closed doors and not on Twitter for the world to see. So, in essence, she's arguing a few things here, and I've seen a lot of leftists on Twitter making similar cases, so let me take each of these points in turn. AOC's first point is that losing a vote on Medicare for All doesn't actually accomplish anything, and there is no plan for what comes next. I disagree. But more importantly, the AOC who fought hard for a vote on a Green New Deal resolution disagrees as well. Look, ultimately, this isn't all that complicated. 300,000 people have died from coronavirus this year. Plenty more are going to be burdened with massive medical bills, which will force them into bankruptcy. 15 million Americans have lost their employer-sponsored health insurance thanks to pandemic layoffs. Medicare for All has never been more necessary, and it's never been more popular. From a political perspective, progressives often get caricatured as focusing too much on niche concerns. This vote would be an effective way to demonstrate that actually progressives are literally the only group in Washington fighting right now for your right to have health care during a pandemic. An up or down vote would also have the benefit of getting everyone on the record so that we know who to primary and have a clear-cut vote to bludgeon them with in that primary. Sure, today, Medicare for All won't pass. But if you make it clear that opposition to Medicare for All spells political death for you, you'll start to see those dynamics change as cynical actors just try to protect their own power. If you don't have the votes today, figure on how to get the votes. Exacting a political price for opposition to M4A is one way to do that. Now, AOC's second point is that maybe there are other, better things that that leverage can be used for. She points specifically to forcing a vote on $15 minimum wage and getting progressives into leadership positions. First of all, I think we should treat a bit skeptically the idea that progressives were totally planning to hold Pelosi's speakership hostage in order to get other things accomplished, since we haven't heard a word to that effect out of anyone until Jimmy raised this issue. Second of all, Biden and Pelosi already support a $15 minimum wage, which has become a centrist position thanks to the leadership of people like Bernie Sanders, who dared to demand such a thing when that position, like Medicare for All is today, was considered to be hopeless and performative. Now, it would be weird to use your leverage to force a vote on something they're already committed to. On the idea of forcing some progressives into leadership positions, that position does actually have some merit. The case that David Sirota, Ryan Grimm, and Stoller, among others, have been making is that a vote on M4A is actually not enough of an ask. Sirota has a new piece up listing five additional ways that progressives could use their leverage to drive towards the goal of Medicare for All. And I think that piece is actually additive and it's useful. For one, you could also fight for a vote on Rokana's legislation to allow states the latitude to set up their own single-payer systems. Sure, down for all of that. But also, make sure you don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good here. If you can get more than just a Medicare for All vote, then by all means, go for it. But right at the moment, we aren't getting a commitment to use the vote as leverage to get leadership positions or votes or to do anything at all right now. So let's start with the basics. AOC's final argument is perhaps her weakest. She responds to Stoller that actually progressives are making demands, we just don't know about them. Look, might be true, but the hard fact of the matter is not one single person in Congress deserves a just trust me at this point. Not after how they all went along with the original sin of the coronavirus stimulus negotiations, the CARES Act, which ensured that big businesses would face no hardship whatsoever, and regular people and small businesses would have to grovel every month or so, hat in hand, for some scrap of help to keep their doors open or food on the table or a roof over their heads. They don't deserve a just trust me when they didn't fight Democratic leadership to get payrolls backstopped in the Democratic House offering early on, as has been done in nearly every other developed nation. They don't deserve a just trust me after Ro Khanna was the only Democratic member of Congress to speak out before the election when Pelosi put her political game playing over the possibility of a $1.8 trillion stimulus deal. If we don't see the hardball that you're playing, there is no reason for us to trust that it is happening behind the scenes. Finally, while it is true that one aspect of a Medicare for All vote is performative, it's also true that a large part of politics is performance, is knowing how to rally grassroots support, clarify who's on which side for the public, and demonstrate to your base that they've got fighters in elected office ready to extract concessions. AOC has had a gift at times for understanding that better than anyone. Today, progressive's strongest asset is not institutional power, but a large grassroots base ready to be mobilized if you give them a reason. Forcing a Medicare for All floor vote would be a shot across the bow to leadership, but almost as importantly, an indication to the Bernie left that progressives are, in fact, ready and willing to do battle. All that being said, the most important point is this one. People deserve health care. And if you believe that, then go out and fight for it. And Sagar, it's an interesting, like, specific dynamic, but I think it also says a lot about something we talk about here, theories of change and using political power. Progressives don't have standard issue institutional power right now. They just don't. They have no control. Leadership is devoted to crushing them and smashing them and obliterating them in all the ways possible. So if you're going to be a minority faction who's going to be able to do anything and wield any sort of influence, you have to take a page out of the Freedom Caucus's playbook.
Yes.
Be willing to hold things up, be willing to be a gigantic pain in the ass, threaten government funding, threaten Pelosi's speakership. You have to show a willingness to do this. Medicare for All right now, there could not be a single issue where the gap between like what the public supports and what the reality is here in Washington, it's one of the issues where there's the greatest gap. So it makes sense that that would be the place where you focus your energy. And yeah, look, if you can use that leverage to get more than that, by all means, go ahead and do it. But just seeing this floor vote and seeing the willingness of progressives to try to do battle and flex some kind of muscle would be good in and of itself.
Yeah, and this is the, I mean, look, I don't know why this is difficult to understand. And especially, you know, whenever she's like, basically, trust me, it's like, okay, and again, look, I'm an outsider looking in. But, you know, the Congressional Progressive Caucus is one of the biggest failures of this entire story. Only one of their members actually came out and advocated Nancy Pelosi moving forward with the stimulus bill. Ro Khanna, they have, what, 100 members, something like that? Not one. Same thing on the stimulus checks, making sure that, I mean, HEROES Act was largely fake, but whenever it all mattered in some of the, what was it, coronavirus, the bailout 1.0 and 2.5 and 3.5 and all that, they got not one victory.
Yeah.
And to the extent that there will be a victory, if anything, or at least some sort of fight, it is two individual senators of Republican and Democrat, Bernie Sanders and Josh Hawley. So what exactly are you doing here? And I think Jimmy is that he's somebody sitting in California and maybe made the mistake of believing that some of these people believe what they say. And they're like, oh, yeah, when they said they were going to fight for this, they're actually going to do it. But they're not. And you can see, and look, I accept Sirota and many of these other procedural arguments. I think very much in those terms. But for those people to have the credibility to say this is what we're actually going to get, then they need to show some sort of fight on the issues that they purport to care about.
Yeah.
And that hasn't materialized.
And look, Jimmy Gunn should get a lot of credit here because,
forced her to respond.
He forced her to respond. Right. He forced this whole conversation was not happening. So the idea that it was like, oh, no, we were totally leveraging our votes for Speaker. You're just not seeing him. I mean, come on. No one was saying any of this before he forced the issue.
Yes.
And look, I think another part of the pushback from the left has been partly like Jimmy can be very abrasive. I love the guy, but he's very direct. He doesn't pull any punches. And sometimes that rubs people the wrong way. So I think part of this is also like some people want to find a reason to be opposed to this. But it's funny to me because, you know, normally the criticism of Jimmy is like he goes too hard.
Yeah.
And in this instance, what he's asking for is very doable and it's very
simple.
Practical.
Right.
So some of the criticism has actually been, well, you're not going hard enough. I'm like, come on, this is Jimmy Dore. Are you being serious? So look, if you can get more, go for more. But Medicare for All is the issue where there is the most agreement between not only the Sanders left, but if you poll the Democratic Party, if you poll the country at large, this is a popular issue. Get people on the record. Primary those who were pretending to support Medicare for All and don't really, or those who are just adamantly opposed, use this vote to bludgeon them and finally demonstrate to the country and to your base that you are actually willing to fight for something that people really need and really care about right now that is being left off the table entirely by every other faction in Washington.
Look, this is really just a fight about political power. And Jimmy's like, hey, you guys got elected. You know, he's the first person, I think, to put AOC on his show. He's like, I helped you and so that you could do something. So do it. I mean, she claims she voted against the CARES Act. No evidence of that. If you go listen to the vote, I mean, what did she really push on stimulus checks? What did her and the squad push with the CPC? I mean, every fight that you can see, they are completely MIA. So I think it's reasonable for him to say, why haven't you done the things that you said you were going to do?
Yeah.
And maybe you should go out and do something about it. He wants them to exercise political power. Now, look, they don't actually have that many votes, but they have large media personalities. And because of Pelosi's idiocy, has a very, very tight margin. So now you actually do have power. Look, the Freedom Caucus drove John Boehner out of Washington.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ask him, into an early grave, whenever that time does come, because of how much he probably had to smoke extra cigarettes in order to get through all of this and drink red wine. So, like, look, you can have a lot of power here if you choose to. A small and dedicated group have overthrown speakers. They have forced votes. You should go back. I mean, this really just shows me they are not serious political actors because they don't understand power. They don't understand D.C. in particular. And, you know, enjoy your committee vote or your committee seats or whatever, because I think we all know how that's going to turn in the next 5 years.
It's the Elizabeth Warren pass.
Yeah, and it failed,
you know,
right?
How is she enjoying her new cabinet position as Treasury Secretary or her vice presidential nomination, right?
Good luck.
They will never give you anything. They're never going to put you in a position of power. It's not going to happen. The only thing you have when you're in a minority faction like this is, frankly, to act a little bit crazy.
Yeah.
That's the thing you have to do for you to be able to threaten and for it to be credible.
Mm-hmm.
This is a prime opportunity, and you're exactly right. All Jimmy is pointing out is, hey, don't pretend like you can't do anything. You have a moment right now when you can. Let's see if you're going to take it.
That's right.
All right, Sagar, looking forward to your radar. That's next.